Welcome to the lecture on recycling of lithium-ion batteries. My name is Shoshana Brahmi and I'm an assistant professor at the Department of Material Science and Engineering at the TU Delft. In today's lecture, there are two main learning objectives. The first is to understand the motivation behind battery recycling, as well as the general structure of a battery cell. And for the second, you will learn about three important recycling routes, namely pyrometallurgical, hydrometallurgical, and direct recycling. Now, without further ado, let's move on to the next part of this presentation. Battery recycling is a timely topic, with lithium-ion batteries playing a crucial role in the electrification of our society and in our daily lives. The demand for lithium-ion batteries is expected to rise 14-fold in the coming decades due to the increasing popularity of electric vehicles. Meeting this demand will require massive amounts of raw material mining, extraction, and refining. These activities have significant environmental consequences. For example, the EU is heavily reliant on external suppliers for certain materials used in lithium-ion batteries. These materials are cobalt, nickel, and lithium, to name a few. As a result, there is a high risk of shortage and price volatility, putting pressure on the EU's ambitious energy transition goals. Recycling of spent lithium-ion batteries has the potential to provide an important source of secondary raw materials. This topic has become increasingly important with many ongoing developments and opening of recycling facilities expected in the coming years. While the specifics of each recycling method will vary, I will walk you through the fundamentals of various recycling technologies and their general characteristics. First, we must examine the structure of a battery cell. Although battery cells vary in size and shape, their basic structure is identical. Generally, a battery cell consists of cathode, an anode, a polymer separator, and a supporting electrolyte in which lithium ions move. This type of battery typically employs a graphite anode and a lithium metal oxide cathode of various chemistry that can contain lithium, cobalt, nickel, manganese, aluminium, iron, and phosphate. Since the active materials are prepared in powder form, they are glued to a thin metal foils that are used to conduct the electric current. These metal foils are made of aluminium for the cathode and copper for the anode. The whole basic structure is soaked in an organic electrolyte containing lithium salt, and it is enclosed in a protective casing typically made of steel, aluminium, or plastics. The varied material content of a battery cell and different geometries for which the composition is also different per brand, type, and year of manufacturing makes generic recycling extremely difficult. Batteries are not designed for recyclability and therefore complete disassembly and separation of components and their respective materials is difficult. In addition, dealing with lithium-ion batteries require a high level of precaution due to fire risk from damage or short circuits. Despite these challenges, there are many incentives to recycle spent lithium-ion batteries. First, recycling will improve the overall sustainability and address environmental and safety concerns. Utilizing batteries as secondary raw materials will increase the market supply resilience. Finally, recycling is motivated by economic interest, as these batteries contain significant amounts of valuable metals. An important driver for battery recycling is governmental policy. For example, since 2006, EU legislation has made manufacturers responsible to arrange the collection and recycling of their batteries under the so-called extended producer responsibility. This is frequently carried out through collaboration with third parties who facilitate the collection and recycling processes. In the Netherlands, for example, this is organized by Stibat for small batteries and ARN for batteries in vehicles. From an environmental standpoint, the optimal destination for EV batteries when the vehicle is being disposed of, when possible, is second life in less demanding application. such as stationary energy storage. This provides the shortest and hence the most efficient route to close its life cycle, as illustrated in the diagram. As an example, a 3 megawatt storage system created from both new and used EV batteries is employed at the Johan Cruyff Arena in Amsterdam. It has the equivalent of 148 Nissan Leaf batteries that can store energy from local solar panels and off the grid, thereby assisting in balancing the energy demand during peak hours. However, batteries will eventually reach the end of life, with recycling being the best option to recover valuable materials. According to current EU battery regulation, for example, at least 50% of a lithium-ion battery weight must be recycled. The following diagrams depicts the average composition of a typical cell in terms of weight. In the current industrial infrastructure, that 50% of a battery weight requirement can be achieved by targeting recycling of metallic casing and a few valuable metals inside the cell, while other essential elements are largely lost. One way to recycle batteries is via pyrometallurgical recycling, which is a high-temperature route consisting of a few steps. After a simple pre-treatment, the processing starts at relatively low temperature to evaporate the organic electrolyte. Afterwards, all the plastics are decomposed through pyrolysis process, providing additional energy to the process. Finally, some of the primary components in the cathode are smelted and transformed into a metal alloy consisting of cobalt, nickel, copper, and iron. After further treatment to create single or mixed metal oxide salts, these elements can be used as precursors for new batteries. This route focuses on the recovery of a few strategic metals, whereas other elements such as aluminium, lithium, are diluted in the slag, which is a low-value byproduct. And many other elements such as the graphite, the electrolyte, and plastics are lost, generating large amounts of off-gas emissions. Its benefits include a large flexibility regarding the range of battery chemistries and a minimum prior pretreatment. New legislations anticipated in the coming years aimed at strengthening the battery value chain are already causing transition from this traditional industrial practice. In addition to raising the quotas for collection and recycling rates, new batteries in the future will have to be partially made from recycled materials. As a consequence, hydrometallurgical routes are becoming increasingly popular as they allow to recover additional materials compared to pyrometallurgy. Hydrometallurgy begins with a physical pretreatment designed to segregate various components and materials into concentrated streams for subsequent recovery. On small-scale operations, batteries are initially discharged. On an industrial scale, this step is frequently omitted entirely, and instead, batteries are directly shred or crushed into small pieces in an inert or cryogenic environment to reduce their activity and therefore fire and explosion risks. It is possible to then extract the electrolyte for recycling. To remove the binder that connects the active material to the current collectors, either thermal decomposition or dissolution follows. Afterwards, it is possible to use a variety of traditional recycling techniques to separate the battery components into various material streams, including steel, aluminium, copper, plastics, and finally, a fine fraction known as the black mass, which consists of the active electrode materials. The black mass is then treated in aqueous solution to extract metal ions. After the extraction, the aqueous solution will contain a variety of metal ions. To separate and selectively recover the different elements, a combination of procedures is then developed. The two most common methods are chemical precipitation and solvent extraction, both making use of variation in the solubility of elements. The end products are salt compounds that can be directly used to make new batteries. This recycling route recovers a wide variety of products with a high recovery rate and purity. However, it requires a complex pretreatment, consumes large amounts of water and chemicals, and is highly sensitive to the nature of the cathode and the presence of contaminants. Furthermore, it is difficult to separate transition metals that are similar in character, and therefore numerous treatment steps are required for purification. As a solution to that problem, an emerging alternative named direct recycling involves a shorter variation compared to the hydrometallurgical route. In direct recycling, composition of the extracted solution is modified to directly precipitate the required chemistry for remanufacturing of cathode materials. Although it sounds like a perfect solution, this requires a specialized methods for dismantling and pretreatment to avoid external contamination that will have a harmful effect on the efficiency of new battery. This brings us to the end of our lecture. To summarize, battery recycling is driven by the need for sustainability, market resilience, and economic gains. There are three important recycling routes. They are pyrometallurgy, hydrometallurgy, and direct recycling. In pyrometallurgy, the recycling materials are treated in a high temperature to obtain valuable metals. In hydrometallurgy, the recycling materials are treated in aqueous solutions. Compared to pyrometallurgy, hydrometallurgy yields material with higher purity. Lastly, there is an emerging recycling route called direct recycling, which modifies recycling material solution to directly precipitate materials for remanufacturing. Thank you for listening.